was lacking in that sector. And it's easy to construct an example where there is no stable mass. You could imagine a planet where instead of two sectors there were several sectors, red, blue, green, yellow, and you needed one of each to form a reproductive unit. Why do you think, what is sacrosanct about two? We are sitting in such a tiny part of this galaxy, anyway. And you could ask for three sections, four sections, five sections. Is there a stable matter? Again, you can come up with examples of preferences where no matter is stable. Only for the case of two is there, or it is the case that there is always at least one stable matter. This is a mathematical curiosity, I just thought I'd say. More to the point is now, young man, your question, right? Your question. Many minds. Who are asking me about that? I'm now coming to your question, I'm not talking. Imagine now that there are many more women than men, and each man can take prescribe some quota. Actually, I'm now thinking of the real world. So, medical graduates, large number of medical graduates, 30,000 approximately, and small number of hospitals. And each hospital has a quota of how many students it can admit. These quotas change from year to year. So, some hospitals this year will need more people in cardiology, next year it will need more in gastroenterology, and so on. So keep changing. And now also, they have preferences, right? Each student ranks the hospitals in order of preference. Similarly, the hospitals rank the students. A hospital which needs more cardiologists will rank cardiology specialists higher, and so on. So we have given these rankings, and you can ask what is the stable matching. The same definition, slightly adjusted, carries over. You can ask, does there exist a stable matching? And again, you can show that the student proposing procedure will yield a stable matching, same proof. Okay? But now, what does the college do? If I'm a hospital and my quota is 25, I'll look at all the people who apply and pick the top 25. So if only 10 apply, I take all 10 and accept them temporarily. Then next round, if I get another 30, I have 30 plus 10, and I pick the best 25 and release the others, right? So it generalizes in the obvious way, and you get a stable matching, okay? You get a stable matching by the student proposing or the hospital proposing, either. Of course, student proposing procedure is better for students. Huh? And hospital proposing procedure is better for hospitals. So that is, keep that in mind. Third deviation is that you could have partial weight. A guy could have said, I'm not ranking all the women. If there are 20 women, he can say, here is my top 7. And after that, I prefer to be single rather than marry any of the remaining 30. Again, you can define stable and the same by an obvious variation. And the same theorems carried by the same proofs. Okay, so while I did a special case, just to focus your attention, it generalizes completely trivially to polygamy and to partial ranking. We keep all that in mind. Game theory has not yet begun. It's now going to begin. And you have to pay very close attention. What we have done is designed a mechanism by which we are going to do matching. Okay. How does the mechanism work? I told you, we are going to say, I'm going to go back to marriage. I like that problem much more than students can also do. It's easier to talk. We are going to say to the men and the women that, listen, here is my computer. Please mail me a letter, and in your letter write down your preferences. And I get people's reported preferences. I look at them, and from then I will do the, in my head, inside the computer, I do the men proposing procedure. and I will mail back to each man the name of his spouse, and to each woman the name of her spouse. This becomes a game. Now, your strategy, the computer cannot look inside your head and know what your true preference is. All it can see is what you report. What the computer constructs is something stable vis-a-vis reported preferences. But if the reported preferences are not true, it's not truly stable. So, if the mechanism that I have designed gives incentive, it's supposed to produce something stable, right? It's producing stable with respect to reported. But if it incentivizes people to misreport, then it just digs its own grave. So the question is, I have now proved that when the men propose, I want to show that this mechanism does not dig its own grave. So I have to prove that when the men, so I will prove, now by the way, so these two theorems were proved, nothing happened in the subject for many years, and then a very well-known mathematician called Dugin, along with Friedman, proved the result, which I am now going to tell. Suppose the men proposing procedure is false. I ask the following question, take any man. And let's ask, let's suppose others' letters are gone. Okay. We don't, whatever, so others are gone. We are asking, if he mails his true preference, is that a wife? Maybe if he misreports his preference, and there are many ways of doing so, maybe he'll get a better one. Then, bad luck, everything is in disarray. But thanks to Dugin and Friedman, we have the following beautiful theorem. And the theorem is, when the men proposing procedure is followed, no man can ever profit by misrepresenting his preference. So when the men proposing procedure is followed, okay, every man his dominant strategy is to report the truth. He can never do better than by reporting the truth. That's the theorem. That will require a proof. And quite a long proof. I will send the proof to Rohit to give to you. But right now you have to take it on faith. And so, going back to this medical graduates in hospitals, when the student proposing procedure is followed, students will have no incentive to misrepresent their study. Okay. Now, I argue that the student proposing procedure should be followed when you do the magic to hospitals and not the hospital proposing. Why? By the way, for the passive side, women can, when the men proposing procedure is followed, it's not true that women can't profit by misrepresenting their. They can. So, the active side has incentive to reveal. Now, let's look at hospitals and medical graduates. What is a hospital? It's 10 professors sitting around the table, looking at applications, and trying to rank the students. Right? They don't have preferences. The purpose of the meeting is to create them. So, for a hospital to misrepresent its preference is a moot question. The purpose of the 10 professors is to actually come up with a ranking, fighting, whatever. So they are in the business of creating one preference over students, and they don't have anything like a true preference, whereas students are the real people who actually have a preference. They are susceptible to misrepresenting if the opportunity arises. So the only game left is to make sure that the students don't misrepresent. Okay, because then what you will compute will be stable with respect to reported. Reported will be true, so it will be truly stable. And that's one reason why we should follow the student proposal. The second reason is it's best for students. and they are the only real people in the model, and we have to optimize their happiness. So the National Resident Matching Program, which was not this full procedure, but elements of it was actually being followed. You can read up on Google with the hospital proposing procedure. When Gainesville got into action, it was changed. And today the way it's done is the way I told you. Students made references to a central computer. Hospitals are asked to rank students.